So what am I here to talk to you about? Well, here's my theme. Christians are crazy. Okay? How often have you heard that in church? Christians are crazy. Here's what I mean. Back when I was in ninth grade, yes, there was a time when I was in ninth grade, one of my closest friends had just been to a Young Life camp and had just come to know who Jesus was. And he sat me down as one of his close friends. This is someone who's now the dean of faculty at Talbot Seminary. Anyway, he sat me down and he said, "Darrell, you need Jesus." I thought he was crazy. He had a three-point sermon. Sermon went like this. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. You need Jesus. Now, those were his 3 points. And I thought he had absolutely lost his mind because he was up against the challenge that all of us face as believers when we share Jesus to our world. Let me tell you what that is. It is that we are making a case for how unique Jesus is. So how unique is Jesus? Think about that with me for a second. How many people do you know who roam the earth and who claim to be God incarnate in the flesh? Okay, you know anyone else who does that? I mean, if you do, raise your hand, okay? And I don't see any, so, you know, so that's one. And so you're thinking about, well, that's pretty unique. And I'm not talking about divine in the sense of, you know, inspired and directed by God or that kind of thing. No, we're talking about the one person who's ever walked the earth who's the God-man, which is another way to think about this. That is that no other human being who's walked the earth claims to be and to have the role that Jesus claims to have. So that's an uphill climb. You know, the little tape, I always think of the Mission Impossible when I think about this. I go, you know that tape? And your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to proclaim the most unique human being who's ever been. And this tape will not self-destruct in 5 seconds. Okay? So that's where we find ourselves. And so I've been asked today to address the uniqueness of Jesus on the one hand in our pluralistic context. Okay? And to do it in 35 minutes. Piece of cake. Okay? So I'm going to deal with 2 questions. I want to deal with how Jesus is unique. I want to talk about that a little bit and how that works and how to think about that. And then I want to think about how do we have a conversation with the array of worldviews that are out there, that exist, and how do I plug that in, particularly if someone isn't coming from the same place I am as I go to share that. That can be an overwhelming thought to think about, the challenge of that. And so I want to talk about that. So, in fact, I would suggest that challenge can cause us to shut down. I don't even know how to go there. I don't know how to do this. I'll try and do the best that I can, but really I'm feeling really hesitant about being able to do this. And I kind of shut down and I go, well, that's not the Great Commission. The Great Commission is go into yourself and make disciples. And that's not the Great Commission. No, it's go into the world and make disciples. So I want to consider first the uniqueness of Jesus. I want to think about how the Bible does this and how we ought to think about it and how we can think about presenting it. And then I want to deal with the pluralism issue, which is overwhelming and has become more overwhelming in my own lifetime. So let me start by doing it this way. Think about how absolutely unique Jesus is for someone who's never darkened the door of a church. Challenge, right? So how are you going to? No one comes to Jesus this way. Doctor gives someone the swat of life and they go, wah, wah, wah. Jesus, the second person of the ontological Trinity. Wah, wah, wah. Okay, don't worry about the definition of ontological. I'll explain that later. Okay? Yeah, no one comes to Jesus that way. No one inherently understands when they are born how unique Jesus is. That's true of everybody, whether they grow up in a Christian home or not. Someone has to sit down and explain to them, this is who Jesus is. this is why we think this, etc. In fact, even the people who wrote the books of the Bible were not born thinking Jesus is part of the Trinity. Jesus is part of the Godhead. Jesus is a divine human. The writers of the Gospels did not start out from that space. We tend to forget that. So what did it for them? How did they get there? So I want to think about that. So let's think about Jesus' uniqueness for a second. And first, I want to start off by considering the Gospels and the way they work. Okay? So we have four Gospels. Okay? I hope this isn't news to anyone, but it might be. We have four Gospels in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which are sometimes called the Synoptics because they overlap significantly, and John, which kind of sits out there all by itself. And that's actually the way the Gospels work. We've got Matthew, Mark, and Luke that tell the story of Jesus from the earth up. Now, what do I mean? I mean, they start with categories and presenting Jesus in spaces and places and doing things that we can kind of process. You know, I mean, think about the beginning of the Gospels. In two of them, Jesus is a baby, okay? We understand babies, right? I mean, after all, we all were babies at one point, at least the last time I checked. And so we understand that. Now, we do have the virgin birth in there that tells you a little something unusual is going on. But we all start off as babies. Or with the ministry of John the Baptist. John the Baptist is ministering in Mark, and then all of a sudden he turns to another minister, who's Jesus, and we watch him do his thing. And you watch it see how the Bible presents Jesus from the earth up. And we watch it dawn on people who Jesus is. That's in contrast to John, which is the gospel the church likes. Okay? Because John does it this way. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is CNN. Okay? John tells you from the very first verse what he's doing. No earth up for John, it's heaven down. And so and the church loves that because it does all our heavy lifting for us. So we tend to run to John when we talk about Jesus, and we tend to slip by Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but I'm here and I tell this to my students all the time. It's really important to understand how Matthew, Mark, and Luke do it because they're showing Jesus from the earth up. And there, you're watching it dawn on people how people get that it's Jesus. Let's just one example. I wish I had more time for this. This is one of my favorite stories in the Bible, the healing of the paralytic. So the paralytic sits down in front of Jesus. He comes to be healed, right? Jesus says to him at the very beginning, your sins are forgiven. Okay, this is not in the text, all right? But when the paralytic is sitting there in front of Jesus and Jesus says, your sins are forgiven, the paralytic is thinking, that's not why I crashed this party. What in the world are you doing mentioning that? And then Jesus goes on to do this. He says, in order that you might know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, I say to you, get up and walk. And here's what Jesus is doing in this passage. He is showing something that you cannot see, the forgiveness of sins. Anyone seen the forgiveness of sins? You know, by sin, hope you stay away a very long time. Okay? That doesn't happen. I'm going to take something that you can see, someone who can't walk who now can because God has acted. And when that paralytic walks, his walk talks, and the walk says, the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. The Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. And in the midst of this, and the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, there's something else that's going on because what the theologians in the passage have told us is no one has authority to forgive sins but God alone. So that's one way it gets done. Another way it gets done, when Jesus calms the winds and the waves, the disciples who are with him, who are scared out of their wits until he calmed the storm, said, who's this that can command the winds and the waves and they obey him? Do, 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 do. Okay, that's a little bit of that music plus do, little weirdness going on. Okay, it began to dawn on them who Jesus is. And so when we see how it dawns on people who Jesus is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we get a guide into the way of how do you show the uniqueness of Jesus? How do you represent who he is? So that's one way to do it. Or consider the message. Consider the message of the church and what it's doing. So the message of the church is basically this. You don't need to barter with God about your salvation. You don't need to do certain works in order to be saved. The burden of salvation does not lie on your shoulders because God has fixed everything through his Son. Now think about that for a second. And think about the message in relationship to the context of this message. And the context is this. There are only two choices as to what's going on in the world. Either God is engaged with the world and he is engaged in the world through revealing himself and who he is and what he's about and connecting us to himself, or we're on our own, having to construct our own reality and having to think through and search through what makes sense of life. Those are the two options that exist. And you actually hear it in the language of what's said by people who are engaged in life and trying to come to grips with it. I'm searching for who I am. I'm trying to find myself. Okay, I thought you were there the whole time, okay? But we do this. We do this internally. And so when you go in that search, you're kind of firmly suspended in midair. So there's that choice. This is the idea that God is here, he's alive, he speaks, he engages, he cares, he's connected to us. Those are your two options. Or think about how it works. Think about how it works in terms of listening to someone who didn't grow up in a Christian home like I did. I didn't grow up in a Christian home. Yeah, we went to church. We went to church because my parents wanted me to have kind of an ethical background to life. We didn't go for the spiritual reasons that one goes to church. And so you know, when my friend shared with me, I thought he was crazy. I thought he had lost his mind. And if you listen to the testimony of people who have come to faith, who did not grow up in a Christian home, I guarantee you almost all of them have this feature somewhere in the testimony. I met so-and-so, a Christian, not a so-and-so, but so-and-so, a Christian, okay? And I was drawn by the way that they were different. And it caused me to ask questions about what made them different. That's how it works. The changed life that becomes a witness. So the challenge is great because Jesus is absolutely unique. I think sometimes we forget the 2,000 years of church public relations has caused us to forget how difficult our message is for someone who didn't grow up in the church. And how unique Jesus is and how hard that is for the person who's hearing it for the first time. In some ways, when we share our faith, we are in the business of creating categories for people who do not have those categories. Or think about it this way. Sometimes when we share and we share something that we say God says or the Bible says, or we say, you're made in the image, they don't have the categories for that. They can't even hear what we're saying. How do you get there? And the last thing I want you to consider is the resurrection. Now, we celebrated this a couple of weeks ago. And the resurrection's important and central to the church, and we tend to preach the same message every week, but we miss something about the resurrection I don't want you to miss. So if I walk out here, and if this were Easter Sunday, and you can respond when the time comes, and I say, he is risen, what do you say back to me? He is risen indeed. Man, you all know what's going on. Okay. So we talk about the fact that there's an afterlife, that this life isn't all that there is, that there's hope, that there's salvation. Well, all kinds of things go into that. There's something else going on Easter, and it's this. Easter is about the vindication of who Jesus claimed to be. Now, think about that for a second. Why did Jesus go to the cross when he met with the Jewish leadership? They asked him, are you the Son of God? Are you the Messiah? And he said things like, from now on, or yes, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the Father coming on the clouds of heaven. Okay, which is kind of code. And what he was saying is, you can do to me whatever you want. You can crucify me, but one day God's going to vindicate me. And when he vindicates me, I've given you my address. You can contact me at www.righthandofgod.com. I'm alive and I will be coming back and I will be riding the clouds, which in the Old Testament is something only God does. I'll be right, and you will be accountable to me one day. You think I'm the defendant? Boy, have I got you fooled. And so he went to the cross, and that was the dispute. Which the high priest ripped his clothes. He thought it was blasphemy because he didn't think Jesus was who he claimed to be. And so the option is, he's either blaspheming, he's either misrepresenting totally who he is, or he's who he claims to be. And they crucified him. And on Resurrection Sunday, when the tomb went empty, that was God's vote in the dispute. God was showing how unique Jesus is, and what he was claiming about himself, what he's claiming to bring, was the center of everything. So that's our message. That's our claim. And everyone who wrote a book in the Bible, in the New Testament, who's proclaiming that Jesus Christ is Lord, started off in a place where they didn't know who Jesus Christ was, and they weren't thinking about a human, divine figure. Jesus is that unique. And something changed their minds. So how do we take that message to the world? So that's part two. How do we take it? Well, let me tell you kind of where we are and how things have changed, even in my lifetime. So up here, you should see a stat. There it is. Okay, this is coming from the Pew Research Foundation. So this is Pew Research from just a few years ago. This chart at the top charts how many people self-identify as Christians in our culture. And the bottom is how many people claim to be religiously unaffiliated. They're what's called the nones. That's not N-U-N-S, but N-O-N-E-S. There's a big difference. Fully 30% of our population today claims to be religiously unaffiliated. That has jumped from about 6 or 7% in 1970. That means that one out of every three people that you interact with doesn't come with any Christian backdrop. In fact, the challenge of pluralism is even greater than that. Just think about it for a second. Because our world has changed. Ooh, I forgot to bring something. I'm going to walk off stage for a second. Our world has changed because of this device. We are more tightly connected than we've ever been, even though there are more of us than have ever been. So we're more aware of one another. There are more alternatives out there. The amount of choices that people face is almost overwhelming. The amount of information that we have access to is flowing all the time. I can connect with anyone in the world instantly through this device. More of us, more tightly connected. Not only that, but in our own culture, we've lost the Judeo-Christian net. That's what the chart was about. The Judeo-Christian net that used to surround our culture and be a part of our culture is gone. Now, we can long for it to be back, but the reality is it's gone, and we have to function in a culture and in a context that's more mixed and more diverse than it's ever been. So what does this mean? Well, this means that our world is like a Middle Eastern bazaar. I don't know if you've been to a Middle Eastern bazaar. Closest thing we have to a Middle Eastern bazaar in Dallas is North Park. Okay? You go to a Middle Eastern bazaar, you got all these booths, all these people selling stuff. You know, I'll never forget being in Istanbul, going into a Middle Eastern bazaar, and one of the guys greeted me in very good English and said, "The closest way to your mother-in-law's heart is through my shop." So our world is like a bazaar, lots of booze, lots of options, lots of ways to live, and some of the booze are pretty bizarre. And so that's a challenge. That can be overwhelming in terms of what we do. So that means when you say Bible says or God says, they may have trouble with both the words in that sentence. And then where are you? And then what do you do? Or even more challenging in some ways, in some Eastern religions, which are believed by millions of people across the world, There's no such thing as the idea of a soul. The idea of being made in God's image is totally foreign territory. Remember I said to you, when you share Christ, you're in the business of creating categories for people that they may not currently have. How do you do that? That's overwhelming. Now, whatever the challenge, shutting down is not the answer. And so what I'm going to give you is a way to engage that gets over that hurdle. So let's talk about the response. Response is this. The goal is to create categories that people currently don't have. Or another way to say it is to build bridges. To build bridges from where they are to open up the possibility of things for them to think about that they may have never even had the category to think about before. It's a challenge. So how am I going to do this? Well, one approach could be I'm going to learn all the way. I'm going to walk through the bazaar. I'm going to learn all the ways that people think about life and space, et cetera, and fill my head with all that content. That actually is part of the solution to be aware of what's going on around you. We're going to talk about how to get there in just a second. But that's not the key way. The key way, the key how, is relationally. The key way is by showing our faith. The key way is by connecting with that person who's coming from a different place. There's a wonderful scene in the Broadway hit Hamilton. Comes very early on when Aaron Burr is meeting Alexander Hamilton for the first time, and there's a little piece of music, and the lyric goes like this. It goes, talk less, smile more. And I want to play with that a little bit because I actually think that's good advice for the church, only it goes like this. Talk less, show more. Because we're called to be light. We're called to shine in darkness. And so how do you do that? How do I touch someone relationally, regardless of where they are coming from in terms of what's in their heads? Well, the first step is to get what I call a spiritual GPS reading on someone. Okay, you know what a GPS is. Okay, those of you who never work with a technological device and don't know what a GPS is, ask your grandchild. Okay, they will know. So you get a spiritual GPS reading. Here's what you do when you go for a spiritual GPS reading. You put your doctrinal meter on mute. Okay? Just shut it down. It's not going away. It's going to be there. But just put it on mute. Your goal is to understand, as you're engaging with someone, the whys and the wherefores of how that person puts their life together. How they see the world. What they think they're here for. Why are they here? What values matter to them? Those kinds of core questions. And your initial goal is not to assess their answer. That's why your doctrinal meter's on mute. Your initial goal is to simply understand how they put life together. And you're trying, and what you're looking for are values that they have that could be the basis of a conversation. Because they may share a value about how they do that might connect to a value that you have or a value that comes out of the Christian faith. Now, they may take that value and do something else with it, maybe a value with a twist, if I can say it that way. But at least there's a basis for a conversation, and you can begin to build a bridge of getting to know them, and you've made the effort and given them the respect of making the effort to get to know them, and so this effort to understand comes before any assessment that you're doing in your conversations. To relate comes before challenging. That's important. In fact, when you think about the gospel is this odd combination of challenge on the one hand, you know, because we talk about things like sin and the need for forgiveness, and then an invitation on the other to be reconnected to the living God consciously. With what it is that he's done for our behalf. It's challenge and invitation side by side. And some presentations of the gospel are so committed to giving the challenge and that we understand sin and how bad things are, we never get to the invitation and the good news. And then you haven't offered the gospel. You only offered the rationale for the gospel. So it's important to build that relationship in such a way that you can set the table for the conversations that you're going to have that are going to introduce some elements that will be a challenge for people. But here's the other thing that happens when you do it this way. You're setting a tone for how you engage with the person across from you that also opens up the door so that when it's your turn, you can share your whys and wherefores. And if you've done a good job of listening to their whys and wherefores and actually getting to know them and actually let them supply things about the way they see the world that you may or may not understand because you never were a Hindu or a Buddhist or whatever, you have the opportunity to do the same in kind. So this means that you need to be prepared. You need to know how Jesus is unique. You need to be prepared for that when that time comes. But the way you're really going to get there is by relating to a person so that you serve and care for them. You show that they matter. You give them the respect of being made in the image of God in a fallen world. Both of those are important, by the way. So here's the bottom line. You don't have to know the worldview of someone else to get to know the person who's sitting across from you in the table. And anyone can do this. It's not hard. You just have to have one skill. You have to be a good listener. And you have to know how to ask good questions. So let's take a look at this. Let's think about this from a biblical point of view. I have two passages I want to quickly go through. First one is in Acts 4. Acts 4 is an interesting passage. Peter and John have just been arrested and have just been released from jail for the first time. This was the first persecution of the church that Acts lets us know about. Now, ask yourself this question, and this probably will kind of be disturbing to think about, but why were Peter and John arrested? We were arrested. We were guilty of healing somebody in the name of Jesus. That was their crime. They're actually serving and healing somebody. They took someone who wasn't able to walk and gave them the ability to walk. That's a strange world. I mean, that's not normally why I would think one would go to jail. And so they're released, and the community as a whole is praying for this situation that is emerging. We're getting pushback for what we believe and for what we do and for how we minister. Now what should we do? Listen to the prayer. And now, Lord, pay attention to their threats and grant to your servants to speak your message with great courage. And while you extend your hand to heal and to bring about miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus, they pray for two things. They pray for boldness, and they pray to continue to serve the people around them. I'm going to talk a little more about that second one in just a second. When they had prayed, the place where they assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak the word of God courageously. The prayer was answered. Of course, we know about the growth of the early church in Jerusalem and how well the church did there in the midst of this persecution. So let's apply this text. That was quick, wasn't it? Just read the text, and now I'm going to apply it. Let's apply this text. Let me tell you two things they did not pray for. The first is they didn't threaten those who opposed them. They didn't pray to nuke the enemy. You know why they didn't pray to nuke the enemy? They didn't pray to nuke the enemy because people are not the enemy, they are the goal. Great Commission says, don't go into the church and make disciples, or don't go inside yourself and make disciples. Great Commission says, go into the world and make disciples. Jesus, when he was praying in John 17, and he's praying for the unity of those he's about to leave behind, as he goes to the cross, says, I'm not here to pray that you take them out of the world. I'm sending them into the world. I want you to protect them. So they didn't threaten the people opposed. nor did they ask for the persecution to go away. Dear Lord, take this away from us. We don't want the pushback. You know why they didn't do that? Because Jesus spent the entire second half of his ministry saying to the disciples, if you follow me and walk down the crossway, guess what? You're going to be going down the highway called the crossway. Don't be surprised that you get pushback. It's coming with the territory. So they didn't pray for the persecution to go away. What they prayed for was boldness to speak about why Jesus was unique and to be able to show it. And what they prayed for, and this is subtle because the miracles get in the way of us seeing this. What they also prayed for is, may we continue to serve the people who are pushing back against us. They were mirroring what the Old Testament had already taught in Jeremiah 29. Let me encourage you to read Jeremiah 29 sometime this week. If you go to that passage, Israel was taken in captivity. Many Jews were taken in captivity to Babylon. Now, Babylon's not exactly the most friendly society and civilization to the God of Israel that's existed in the history of the world. So it's a pretty hostile environment. And what God says to the Jews who are taken to Babylon is, I want you to serve the city. Same principle, same idea. So we have this example coming out of Acts 4 where this community has rallied together and prayed. They're in the midst of persecution. They know they're getting pushed back. They know they're a numerical minority. And what they pray for is help us to be bold and help us to serve people. Help us to show your presence, God, through who we are. Second passage, Ephesus. Moment I say Ephesus, there should be a picture popping up on the screen here of the Temple of Artemis, I think. There it is. Okay. Home of the Temple of Artemis, one of the eight wonders of the world. You can't tell it from that building, but that building is the size bigger. It's actually slightly bigger than a whole football field being put under one roof. It was so massive, it drew people from all over the world to come and worship Artemis because obviously in the ancient world, they believed in many gods and Artemis was one of them. The whole commerce of the city was built around what was taking place at that temple. Next picture is of what the temple looks like today. That's what's left of it. In Acts, talks about how the gospel came to Ephesus and the effect. So let's take a look. Acts 19, verses 8 to 11. So Paul entered the synagogue and spoke out fearlessly for 3 months, addressing and convincing them about the kingdom of God. But when some were stubborn and refused to believe, reviling the way before the congregation, he left them and took the disciples with him, and he left town. No, that isn't what he did. He left and took his disciples with him, addressing them every day in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. Just went to a different part of town, did the same thing outside the synagogue. This went on for 2 years. He kept doing it so that all who lived in the province of Asia, both Jews and Greeks, heard the word of the Lord, and God was performing extraordinary miracles through Paul's hands. One of the miracles that gets defined on the other end is an encounter with demons in which the Jewish exorcists try to echo the word, the name of Jesus to heal, and the demons say to them, I know Paul, but I don't know who you are. That impressed the people of Ephesus. And so what we see in application is a ministry of word and deed where the word that was preached, God loves you and cares for you and has died for your sins and has offered to fix everything that's wrong with life through what he does for you inside, etc. Their words and their deeds match by showing God's care. They served and showed God's care, and that got the attention of their neighbors. It was a testimony beyond words. It was about what could be seen. It displayed the light, and it raised questions. It built bridges. It created categories the Ephesians previously did not have. What was the result? The result was this. This comes at the end of Acts 19. Many of those who had believed came forward, confessing, making their deeds known. Large number of those who had practiced magic collected their books and burned them up in the presence of everyone. When the value of books was added up, it was found to equal 50,000 silver coins. That was lots of money. And in this way, the word of God continued to grow in power and to prevail. Here's my point. What happened was there were changed hearts and people burned their magic books because they realized their magic books weren't of any use anymore. It did not happen this way. It did not happen by the Ephesian city council passing a law saying the book should be burned. It happened because there were hearts transformed from the inside out. Because the only way you get substantive change is when hearts are changed from the inside out, which is why the gospel is so necessary for being a part of what we do and who we are as we shine the light on him. So I'm done. What have I said? This is what I've said. How do we cope with pluralism? We cope with pluralism by letting our faith and care be on display. Shine as lights. Be who we're supposed to be. We cope with pluralism by listening and learning, looking for the values coming from other people that we can connect with that could be the basis of a bridge conversation. We are also prepared to discuss why we believe Jesus is unique. In other words, we're called to be light, and the way that we're called to be light is to serve and show that God cares so that when we share with people, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life, and he's put it in what he's done through Jesus as he fixes everything that we need to fix so you're no longer suspended in midair, but you understand and connect to the God who made you in his image. That makes sense. Because we've shown that we care. And then if you don't know Jesus, my simple request to you is to consider his uniqueness and consider what's on offer. It may save you a lot of work to make some sense out of your life. Rather than being out there suspended in midair and picking and choosing what might be true and what might be going on and searching for yourself, etc., it may be that there's a God out there who made you and shaped you, designed you for a relationship with him, recognize that we aren't all that we ought to be, and went about the business of fixing that through his son, who not only made a provision in dying for sin, but offers to give of himself and to come into our lives and do a work from the inside out so we can be the human beings that we were designed to be. I'm thinking of that commercial that used to show up in NFL football games. You make the call. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time, for your care for us, for the uniqueness of Jesus and who he is on the one hand, and the reminder on the other that even though we may not understand the variety of booze in the bazaar, that we can always get to know someone and build a bridge towards them. Teach us to listen well, to love well, to serve well, and to reflect your goodness and grace in our lives as we testify to the goodness that you bring through your unique one, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.